अब मैं प्रोफेसर मोहम्मद मियाँ साहब, इज़्ज़त मआब वाइस चांसलर मौलाना आज़ाद नेशनल उर्दू यूनिवर्सिटी से दरख्वास्त करता हूँ कि वो आज के मेहमान खसूसी को टीचर्स डे लेक्चर पेश करने के लिए दावत दें। प्रोफेसर मोहम्मद मियाँ साहब,
प्रोफेसर मोहम्मद मियाँ, डिस्टिंग्विश्ड वाइस चांसलर, प्रोफेसर खदीजा बेगम, रजिस्ट्रार इंचार्ज, डिस्टिंग्विश्ड गेस्ट, सीनियर ऑफिसर्स, फैकल्टी एंड स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ द यूनिवर्सिटी, रिप्रेजेंटेटिव्स ऑफ द मीडिया, फ्रेंड्स, एट द आउटसेट लेट मी कन्वे Teachers' Day greetings to every one of you. I also would like to take this opportunity to express my sincere appreciation and congratulations to the university, to the Maulana Azad National Urdu University, for the distinguished service it is doing in the cause of the society. Great achievements are achieved. Registrar just now presented some of the important features of achievements of this university. I had the privilege of associating, as very distinguished colleague said from the beginning, I had the privilege of associating with this university when Professor Shamim Jarazpuri was the first vice chancellor, when Professor Pathan was the second vice chancellor, and present vice chancellor Professor Mohammad Mia happens to be a close friend of mine also. We had the opportunity of working together at Indira Gandhi National Open University. So I also would like to congratulate you. You are very fortunate, the university is very fortunate from the beginning to have a very distinguished teachers as the vice chancellors of this university. Professor Shamim Jarazpuri, a distinguished scientist, Professor Pathan, a distinguished scientist, Professor Mohammad Mia, a distinguished educationist. Nationally known figures. Very few universities will have this type of a privilege of being headed by a very distinguished academics. So these are the very distinguished teachers. The achievements are result of the leadership provided by them and the hard work of all the staff and the students of this university. So I would like to congratulate you for this. I also would like to thank the university Vice Chancellor particularly, and all of you, for this opportunity to spend some time with you on the occasion of Teachers' Day. Just now, about Radhakrishnan's contribution is very beautifully presented. In 62, when some friends approached him for celebrating his birthday, he said, instead of celebrating my birthday, why don't you celebrate it as a Teachers' Day? That only shows the collective consciousness of the great person. It is not his birthday which is important, it is the birthday of teachers which is important, teachers' birthday. From 1962, it became September 5th, Teachers' Birthday. As all of us know, UNESCO also is celebrating World Teachers' Day. They celebrate it on October 5th. UNESCO, which has the goal of building peace in the minds of people through education, considers teachers a very important role to play in the social transformation. That's why it is celebrating October 5th as the World Teachers' Day, as a recognition to celebrate the essential role of teachers in providing quality education at all levels. In some countries, I think February 28th is celebrated as a Teachers' Day. In some Arab countries, I think you are celebrating it as a Science Day. So the point is, the importance of teachers' role is recognized not only in India, throughout the world, it is recognized. All developing countries particularly, they recognize that they have a critical role in the social transformation. So the Maulana Azad University is celebrating it as a Teachers' Day, and I'm also very happy that they are organizing some lectures on that day. There are different ways of celebrating Teachers' Day. One way of it is organizing a lecture, because this is an occasion for reflecting on the role of teachers, reflecting on the role of education in general. I propose to speak on the challenges of universities aiming at excellence. I selected this topic maybe for two reasons. I have some experience of working in an organization in India which has the responsibility of promoting excellence in higher education. National Assessment and Accreditation Council. People think that it is an accrediting agency, but to me, it is a facilitating agency of excellence in higher education in India. I had the opportunity of working in that organization. I thought that I can share that experience also with you. The second reason is, today, every university is talking about quality and every university is talking about excellence. So what are the challenges faced by the universities aiming at excellence? In my presentation, I would like to make three arguments, present three propositions. My first argument is, excellence makes the difference. This is a very obvious thing. Everybody knows. There is no contradiction about it. There is no dispute about this statement. If I say that, excellence makes the difference. Why I am saying excellence makes the difference? Philip Albeck, a distinguished international educationist, he made a very interesting observation. A world-class country without a world-class education is the contradiction of 21st century India. If you see Indian education system, ours is the third largest in the world in terms of the numbers in higher education. After China, maybe 20 million students or a little bit more. Second, America with 16 million students. And third, India with 14 or 15 million students in terms of numbers in higher education. In terms of the number of higher education institutions, maybe probably this is the largest. We have around 450 universities. We have around 22,000 colleges in the country. But the question is, how many of them can come under the category of excellent higher education institutions? There are many world rankings done by the many international agencies. There is a criticism that maybe one or two only are finding a place among the first 100 best universities in the world, or maybe first 200 best universities in the world. We have large numbers, but the question is, how many of them are of excellent institutions? Excellence as an outstanding performance is considered as one of the three concerns of higher education in India. Veerappa Mouli Committee, Government of India appointed some time back a committee to examine the higher education system. They have identified three concerns. One is the concern of expansion, that means access to more numbers. Second is the concern of inclusion, that means access to the weaker sections, access to the poor, access to the rural, access to women, access to minorities. That is, inclusion is the second concern. And third concern is excellence. The quality and excellence is the third concern. So when we are looking at higher education system, the excellence as one of the important concerns is recognized. Mere access is not a sufficient condition. It is a necessary condition. Yes, there is a need for expansion. There is a need to include, need to provide higher education opportunities to the rural people, to the minorities, to the women. But these two itself, by themselves, are not sufficient. They are necessary conditions. Only if you include the third important concern, exclusion, maybe it becomes a sufficient. So our concern is now, how do you make higher education in India an excellent system of higher education? So the 450 universities when we have, every university must aim at excellence. Here when I am talking about excellence, I am talking about excellence as a social concern, the purpose of education. There is a reference to the Radhakrishnan's remark. Radhakrishnan said, education should not only make students intellectually competent and professionally skillful, but also civilized in emotions and refined in purpose. Let me also permit me to quote Nehru's idea of university, Jawaharlal Nehru's idea of university. In 1947, convocation address to Allahabad University, he very brilliantly put the purpose of university education. The university shall stand for humanism, for tolerance, for the adventure of ideas, and for the search for truth. When we are looking for universities with excellence, we are looking for this type of universities. Universities who can develop all-rounded personality, universities who can contribute for the social development, universities which can make a difference to the society. That's why when we say excellence makes a difference, means universities must be able to make a difference to the society. Sometimes we find the excellence also is motivated by profit motives. You find some of the private institutions, they are very good institutions. They are also excellent institutions. But their main concern is, how do you make profit by excellence? But that is not a social model which we are looking. We are looking at a model of a university which want to exceed in excellence, achieve in excellence by serving the society. Excellence as a service is different from excellence as a profit. You can provide excellence with the aim of making a profit, but you are not concerned about inclusion, you are not concerned about expansion. You are concerned only about excellence. But excellence with similar concern for expansion, excellence to large number of students, excellence with similar concern to inclusion, excellence for rural children, excellence for weaker sections of the students. So these three concerns must be combined. If you separate them, it will not have a social purpose. So the first argument I am making is, excellence makes a difference. If you want to differentiate between one university and another university, it is the excellence which makes the difference. And excellence for society, or excellence for service, excellence with the aim of development. This is the second important consideration when we are looking at the excellence. So everyone is talking about excellence, but the problem is here, why we are not able to have excellent universities in this country? Not many. There are some excellent universities also. I'm not saying that all universities are not excellent. But why 450 universities have not become excellent universities? Why 22,000 colleges have not become excellent colleges? We are not merely concerned with 100 colleges or 500 colleges becoming an autonomous colleges and excellent colleges. Not the 20 universities becoming excellent universities. What will happen to 430 universities if you are aiming at only 20 universities as excellent universities? So our excellence is a universal concern. Our excellence is a social concern. Our excellence is a concern to make a difference. This is my first argument. My second argument is, the question is raised, why we are not able to achieve that goal? What are the challenges faced by the universities to attain the status of an excellent university? To me, there are four essential requirements to ensure the excellence of any higher education institution, any education institution for that matter. These four factors to me are, let me very briefly explain these four factors. One is competent staff and motivated students. Staff makes all the difference, as all of us know. Educational institution, it is the academic staff, it is the quality of the academic staff that makes the difference. Whatever may be the methodologies you are adopting, whatever may be the technology you are adopting, the competence of the staff is a very critical factor. Competence along with the commitment also. Sometimes we have a very interesting situation. Some people are very competent, but they are not equally committed to the institutional goals. sometimes are very committed to the institutional goals, their competencies are very limited. So this combination of these two factors, competence and commitment, the staff is very, very important. I always feel there are four kinds of staff. Two extremes. One extreme is they are very competent and committed staff. Then there are competent staff, but they are not committed. Their commitment is outside and they want to use their competence to acquire more credit, to make more money or to get some assignments outside, but their commitment to the institutional goals is very limited. So their competence, there is no doubt. This is the second category of the staff. The third category of the staff, they are very sincere people, they are very committed people, their levels of competencies are very low. This is the third category. And there is also a fourth category, unfortunately, they are neither committed nor competent. So all these four categories are there. An excellent institution is looking for committed and competent. Excellent institution must encourage, must examine why a committed fellow is not competent. If you can make him, you see, the competent, that means that's why academic staff colleges, 50 academic staff colleges, UGC is trying to make them competent. And then there is a competent people who are not committed to the institution. Then you have to see how do you motivate them? How do you motivate? What is dragging them outside the university? Why they are not giving their best to the university? You have to look into that. Institution has to look into that. Unfortunately, if they are not committed and competent, probably you must be able to develop a mechanism whereby you can get rid of them. It is very difficult in a public organization system, but that's why any best institution, if you want to learn from the best private institution, I was reading something about Infosys. The Narayanamurthy was writing about how they were able to develop that institution as the best institution. He was telling the seven founders of the Infosys, one decision they took, none of their relatives, if they don't really deserve, they should not find any place in that organization. They should not give any recommendation of recruitment of any of their relatives in that organization. That was the decision they took. That's why that organization became a world-class organization. If you want to recruit your own people and make it a world-class organization because your people are not world-class people, see, then you can't make it a world-class organization. If you want to make a world-class organization, recruit world-class people. So the teachers, selecting the right type of teachers, giving them encouragement to give their contribution, making best use of their talents is the challenge of a university, the committed staff. Equally important is motivated students. Because the students must have a desire to learn. If you have a desire to learn, then you know how to use the institution for your learning purposes. You must demand excellence. You must demand quality. Many students' friends are here. Sometimes we get all sorts of situations. I'm not saying the students of this university are of that type. Maybe an exception you are. But sometimes students are more interested in getting the degree than getting the learning experience. See, degree acquiring becomes very important because if you acquire a degree, you will get some job. Sometime back, I was told, in America, it is a few years back, in America, some study was conducted on their objectives of pursuing education. This is a study conducted among the students of American universities. Why you are pursuing your higher education? This was the question asked American students. Most of them answered that to make more money in later years, after getting the degree, to make more money. And the teaching, learning and assessment strategies. Today educationists, Professor Mohammad Mia knows better, educationists are talking about outcome-based education. What is that you expect students after they graduate from this university? What is the knowledge outcome you are expecting? What is the skills outcome you are expecting? What is the attitude and values outcomes you are expecting? What is the behavior outcome you are expecting after the graduation, after the post-graduation, after they study some program in this university?
They study MA Urdu. They study history, MA Economics, MSc Chemistry. These are all the subject based. There's some knowledge they are expected to acquire. But what type of skills they are expected to acquire? What type of values they are expected to acquire? So when you are providing education, that's why we talk about what is called as a objective-based education. What are these objectives? List out these objectives. Then evolve the learning strategies. Then evolve the assessment strategies. This is very important. Otherwise, what will happen? Paulo Freire, Brazilian educationist, he characterized education system in general, banking system. He called it as a banking system. Banking system means where the teachers are expected to deposit knowledge in the minds of the students. And the students are expected to take out that at the time of examinations, omit it. Teachers to deposit knowledge, students to take out that knowledge at the time of examination. After the examination, it is empty mind. Because he has taken out and his purpose is over, he has written the examination. If he gets good marks, it's okay. If he doesn't good marks, he will say that teacher has not deposited the knowledge properly, or I am not able to take out that knowledge from the bank properly. So this is what Paulo Freire called it as a banking system of knowledge. So what is the pedagogy we are looking, the pedagogy of the oppressed? He called it as a pedagogy of the oppressed. That means, as students, as learners, the education must enable us to understand our environment, understand the context in which we are living, also must give us the abilities to change that context to our requirements. That's how education can play a transformative role. Otherwise, education is not a transformative tool. Education is only gives you some knowledge, some skills sometimes. That also, as you know, educationists are talking, employers are talking. Only 25% of the engineering graduates coming out of more than 1500 or 1600 engineering colleges in the country, they have the necessary work skills required for industry. There is a wide gap between the world of work and the world of education. There is a wide gap between the world of education and world of life. I am reminded of T.S. Eliot's, with respect to T.S. Eliot, when he said, "Where is life which is lost in living? Where is wisdom which is lost in knowledge? Where is knowledge which is lost in information?" To me, where is learning which is lost in education? To me, where is education which is lost in teaching? To me, where is teaching which is lost in lecturing? Particularly, I come from social sciences. The teachers in social sciences, we feel, for us, teaching means lecturing, going to the class and giving a lecture. Sometimes students may not listen also, but that's what we can do. What can we do? We can't do anything more than that. But education has a bigger goals. Learning has a bigger goals. So the pedagogy, the methodologies which we are adapting as the teachers, we must be able to adapt the methodology which will give a learning satisfaction to the learner. That learning satisfaction, that experience, that learning experience, the 3 years or 4 years or 2 years you are spending in the university, the learning experience, it depends upon what type of activity you are doing, how you are doing it. So the second requirement is what I call relevant programs and appropriate teaching, learning, and evaluation strategies. And the third one is good infrastructure and resources. Any university, if it is to undertake all these activities, it requires good infrastructure. Fortunately, if you see that, this is one of the universities where I find that you have a good infrastructure. Good infrastructure in terms of the laboratories, in terms of the other facilities, in terms of the library, and more particularly today in the 21st century, when we are talking about a good infrastructure, the infrastructure in terms of the technology. Today we are talking about a technology-enabled education. And very interestingly, as you know, this university has a very distinction. This is the, I find, maybe the first conventional university in the country which started its programs through the distance mode. More than 100 conventional universities are offering distance programs today, but all of them first started with a conventional program and later they went to the distance education program. But when Professor Shamim Jarajpuri was the first vice chancellor, we were working at the time in the Ambedkar Open University, we had a collaboration, and he said, let me start immediately, I will take up some of your Ambedkar Open University programs, and as a collaborative arrangement we will offer the program. So today technology is being used for education purposes, is a very important supportive tool. That's why technology enabled education, it has all the potentialities, lot of potentiality. Technology enables you to have access to the learning, to have access to the knowledge, easy access to the knowledge, new knowledge, easy communication, effective communication, it has many facilities. So when you are looking at a good infrastructure, I'm not merely looking at the brick and mortar infrastructure, I am looking at the technology infrastructure, I am looking at the library or infrastructure. When we are looking at a good infrastructure, we also must realize that it has two dimensions. One is availability of infrastructure is one dimension. The second dimension is proper use of this infrastructure is the second dimension. Sometimes we have the infrastructure, we are not able to make proper use of that infrastructure. Underutilization of the infrastructure is one of the big problems. I don't know how effectively the library facilities are used here. When I was in the NAC, National Assessment and Accreditation Council, we visited a number of libraries and number of universities. Their problem is, one is resources to create a proper library infrastructure is one problem which they are finding. Second problem is, sometimes the users are not interested to go to the library, students are not interested to go to the library. Students are more interested in examination, getting degree. I was reading Times Higher Education supplement some time back, the Times Higher Education. There, an interesting observation was made by a professor of a university, the condition in British universities. He was telling, the students in British universities, particularly in recent years, they have increased the fees also, in British universities also. And the students have a feeling that we are paying so much. When the teacher asks them to do assignments, when the teacher asks them to go to the library and read, the students are demanding, we are paying so much, don't bother us with all those things, you give us some examination tips and how to get success in the examination. Don't bother us to go to the library regularly and read the books, so many books, how many books you have read, don't ask. And sometimes this attitude, as a result of this, the good infrastructure created by the institutions, the students and staff are not able to make use of it. And the students and staff sometimes, technology also, we have to be more technology friendly in our activities. Then only we can be very effective. And the fourth one is, to me, effective governance system. This effective governance system, the governance must be result-based governance. As you know, in the educational institutions, the governance has a very supportive role. Administrative staff also must understand, university is basically an institution where academics play a critical role. And governance system's role is to support the academics to play that critical role. University system is basically for students, student-centric we talk. Governance system is not a regulatory system. Regulation is only to facilitate. See, sometimes we focus more on regulation than facilitation. The governance system must be so effective, so flexible, so responsive, where the academic must feel happy. That's why UNESCO was telling, the Teachers' Day, when the UNESCO is celebrating the Teachers' Day, they were emphasizing two important aspects in that. These two important aspects is, one is the academic autonomy. Academic autonomy. Academic autonomy to deliver goods. Academic autonomy to make system more efficient. To make system more relevant. That's why autonomy is necessary to the academic. Autonomy is necessary to the university to take appropriate decisions at appropriate time. Vice Chancellor, Executive Council, Academic Council, all of them must have sufficient freedom to take decisions. That's why the governance system must be facilitated by the external players also, the policy makers and the government also must facilitate the internal governance system. Internal governance system must facilitate the internal players, the academics and the students and the community to achieve the results. So the effective governance system is very, very important. When we consider these are the four as the factors, these four factors, what are the challenges? The challenge is, how do you ensure these four factors? And second challenge is, how do you align these four factors? Sometimes, my NAC experience also, sometimes, Professor Mohammad Mia also visited a number of institutions, he also knows it. Some of the institutions are concentrating more on infrastructure. Sometimes, as you know, the NAC team visits, they show big infrastructure, good infrastructure, yes. We visited some universities, I don't want to name them. They have a good infrastructure. But when we discuss with the students, students are telling, sir, the staff are not taking classes regularly, properly. You have a good gymnasium and you have a good conference center, a good building, but the staff are not taking classes properly. So how do you rate that university? The team has given a lower rating. Vice-Chancellor made a big issue of that lower rating. You can see our campus, you can see our convention center, even the chief minister comes and stays here only. The chief minister may be staying. We are giving ranking to the university, not for lodging of a chief minister. See, the ranking of a university is based on the academic achievement of the university, not that how your guest house is good or bad. These are all good requirements. So alignment of these four factors is very, very important. Good staff, motivated students, good system of pedagogic system, assessment system, good infrastructure, and good governance. Alignment of all these four. That's why these are called as the four pillars of university system. Four pillars of an excellent university. If any one pillar is weak, you see, the building will certainly collapse, as you know. When it is standing on four pillars, four are equally important. No one is important. That's why in the education institutions also, sometimes we have what we call unnecessary quarrels. Sometimes academics think that we are more important than administrative staff. Administrative staff think that we have more responsibilities than the academics. Academics have no responsibilities. This type of unnecessary quarrels within the community also. Also, it results in the community as a whole. Here, the four pillars are equally important. You can't say that one is more important and another is less important. Four pillars are equally important. If you have a good infrastructure but don't have a good staff, no use. You have a good staff but you have a very bad administrative system. The staff would like to leave the institution. You see, because you see here there's no recognition to the quality or recognition to the merit. So all the four are very, very important. The challenge is how do you align them and how do you ensure them. My last argument is, I will say this is action is wisdom. When I say action is wisdom, we have to shift from a paradigm of words as wisdom to action as wisdom. I don't know it's good or bad. Unfortunately, traditionally, we have a very wrong way of judging people also. If he can speak very well, he is considered as a great scholar. Scholarship is not based on merely giving good lectures. Scholarship is based on how analytical you are in your analysis of the matter. And your contribution is based on what actions you are taking. What is that you are doing? Not what is that you are speaking. That's why everybody speaks that quality is necessary. Everybody speaks that excellence is necessary. There's no dispute. That's why my first argument, there's no dispute. But the dispute is about the first argument. Unless the third argument is valid, that means action. Unless you take some action. Action is wisdom. Action only will give the results. Somebody said, God is in details. And when we are looking to the action also, don't look to the savior models. When I say don't look to the savior models, yes, leaders play a very important role. Leadership is very, very important. But excellence is a result of multiplicity of small actions that yield concrete results. Small, small actions. Excellence is the responsibility of everyone. And excellence is a function of everyday greatness. It is the responsibility of everyone and it is the function of everyday greatness. Excellence is not a function of NAC visit. Excellence is not a function of an external inspection. Excellence is a function of all actions of everyone. There is excellence in every act. There is an excellence in organizing a program. There is an excellence in giving a lecture. There is an excellence in laboratory practice. There is an excellence in maintaining records. There is an excellence in communication. There is excellence in every act of university. You identify 100 acts of the university of all the types of functionaries, from the lowest functionary to the highest functionary. There is an element of excellence in every act. The cumulative effect of the excellence of all these acts is excellence. Not me syndrome won't work. That means I'm not responsible. What can I do? I'm coming every day and going. I'm staying here from morning 10 o'clock to the evening 4 o'clock. This is the, I'm doing my job. But everyone has to see that align, how your job can be aligned with others. There are other functions also. We have to look into those things also. So there is no one formula. There is no one magic formula to attain the excellence. And it may take different routes also, depending upon different contests also. As all of us know, if you have to make a contribution, three levels of understanding is necessary. Levels of understanding. One level of understanding is understanding yourself first. That is the first level of understanding. Know yourself. What are your strengths? What are your weaknesses? What contribution you can make? That is knowing yourself is a first. Sometimes we are more fond of knowing about others than about ourselves. See, we don't bother, we don't want to know about ourselves. We think that we know about ourselves, but we don't know what are our weaknesses. We don't know what are our strengths also. Sometimes we ask in the examinations or in the interviews also, as you know, the question sometimes they ask a student, can you give me three of your strengths? I'm not sure how many students will be able to answer properly. They may also ask you, can you give three of your weaknesses? We think that we don't have any weaknesses. Or if we say our weaknesses, how can we say about our weaknesses? Because we are not sure of our strengths. We are not aware of our weaknesses. Then what is that you can contribute? The students must understand when you go to any organization for employment, these are some of the questions. Recently, as you know, I had a discussion. This is my assignment in the Mauritius as a consultant to the government. I had a discussion with a high-level team. They say that they don't say that in an interview, but a discussion. It is an interview, in a sense, it's an interview, but they say it is a discussion. They ask, what is your strength? Then I said, my experience in distance education is my strength. Then they said, what is your limitation? My impatience with the non-excellent people is my limitation. See, this is what this is, you have, everyone has that. See, people say that you must have a patience, but my problem is I don't have a patience with the weaknesses. That may be a problem. You see, like that, everyone, first you must know yourself. The second is you must know your work. You are a teacher, you are an administrator, you are a driver, you are a technician. You must know your work. The third one is equally important. You must know your contest. The contest in which you are working. Unless you know the contest in which you are working, sometimes, as you know, some of the things we may be able to change. Some of the things we have to adjust it. Adjusting capacity also. The change capacity, adjustment capacity, and maintenance capacity, all these functions are necessary. So action is very, very important. To action, understanding is very, very important. That's why, to me, the action depends upon the strong desire, clear understanding, and logically designed actions. Unless you do all these things, we may not be able to achieve the excellence. And there is a role to be played by all players in the higher education. The government has an important role to play. Policymakers have an important role to play. Their support is very critical. That's why, to me, what we call as the political will and the political support and the government support or the system support, external system support, is equally important. And the action at the institutional level is equally important. Then only we will be able to achieve the results. So all of us must assume that all of us are interested in achieving excellence. That's why building institution is a matter of faith. Faith in our beliefs, faith in our vision, and faith in our values. It is a matter of faith in our collective wisdom. If you are able to build the institution, it is a reflection of our collective capability. If you are not able to build a good institution, it is also a reflection of collective failure. No use of any blaming on one person or one situation. All of us must have some responsibility. If we realize that, certainly we will be able to make a good contribution. I am sure Urdu University, Maulana Azad National Urdu University, will certainly is a very important institution, is a very important national institution. Nation has a lot of expectations from this institution, and this is expected to play a very important role with the support of all of you under the leadership of Professor Muhammad Mia. The university, I am hopeful that will certainly play a very important role. It is already in the process. Excellence is a journey. You will take forward the journey initiated by the first, second vice chancellor and the third vice chancellor with the support of all the staff will take forward this journey to reach the excellence. Thank you very much. Wish you all the best.
Challenges of universities aiming at excellence. Afziliyat ki khwahan jamiat ke liye darpesh challenges. Is bade hi ahem mauzu par Professor V.S. Prasad, आज के प्रोग्राम के सदर मोहतरम वाइस चांसलर प्रोफेसर मोहम्मद मियां साहब से दरख्वास्त करता हूं कि वो अपने सदारती कलिमा से हम सब को मुस्तफीद करें. प्रोफेसर मोहम्मद मियां साहब.
काबिल इज्जत मोहतरम जनाब वी एस प्रसाद साहब, मेरे साथियों और तालिब इल्मों, ये एक ऐसा मौका है कि जब मैं ये महसूस करता हूँ कि हमको थोड़ा सा इंट्रोस्पेक्शन भी करना चाहिए एज ए टीचर और एज स्टूडेंट्स. और प्रसाद साहब ने हमें काफ़ी मौका दिया है इस तरफ अपने आप को एग्जामिन करने का कि हम कहाँ स्टैंड करते हैं. प्रसाद साहब के साथ मैंने बहुत ज़माने तक काम किया और ये वजह नहीं है कि प्रसाद साहब को मैंने यहाँ बुलाया, ये भी मैं बताना चाहता हूँ. जब मेरे सामने ये एक फाइल आई कि टीचर्स डे फंक्शन हम बाकायदा करते हैं और उसमें किसी मेहमान को बुलाते हैं ख़ास स्पीकर की हैसियत से, तो मैंने एक सीनियर प्रोफेसरान की एक टीम बनाई और उनसे ये दरख्वास्त की कि वो चंद नाम सजेस्ट करें. मैं आपको ये भी यकीन दिलाना चाहता हूँ कि उस टीम को मैंने कोई ब्रीफिंग नहीं दी थी और जब फाइल वापस आई तो उसमें चार नाम थे और चार नाम में प्रसाद साहब का नाम था, तो ये बहुत ही नेचुरल था मेरे लिए कि मैं प्रसाद साहब का नाम सेलेक्ट करूँ. दिस इज हाउ ही हैज बीन हियर. ये बात जितनी भी कही गई हैं उनको दोबारा रिपीट करना मुनासिब नहीं है, लेकिन एम्फेसाइज करना शायद ज़रूरी है कि कुछ चीज़ें जो बहुत हम महसूस करते हैं और शायद जिनकी वजह से कुछ अच्छाइयाँ भी होती हैं और कुछ ख़राबियाँ पैदा होती हैं, वहाँ पर बहुत ही वाज़े तौर से प्रसाद साहब ने इशारा किया कि यूनिवर्सिटी के चार सतून हैं, किसी भी इमारत के सुतून होते हैं, अगर कोई भी कमज़ोर होता है तो इमारत के सीधे खड़े रहने का शायद इम्कानात कम हो जाते हैं. किसी भी सुतून को मेरे ख़्याल से अगर आर्किटेक्ट जो है वो ये तमीज़ नहीं करता कि ये कमज़ोर होगा या बराबर होगा, उसमें सीमेंट और सरिया बराबर ही लगता है. और यही वजह है कि एक इमारत की मजबूती के लिए जितने स्टेक होल्डर्स हैं उन स्टेक होल्डर्स पर बराबर ध्यान दिया जाए तो इमारत की देखभाल बेहतर हो सकती है और तालीमी इमारत जो है वो शायद इसी पर मबनी भी है. और ये मैं शायद आपको याद दिला दूं कि जो लास्ट यूनेस्को रिपोर्ट, इंटरनेशनल एजुकेशन रिपोर्ट थी, उसके सिलसिले में भी पिलर्स की बात कही गई है. अगर तालिब इल्मों ने अभी उसको नहीं पढ़ा है और टीचर साहिबान ने नहीं पढ़ा है तो उस पर अगर तवज्जो फरमाएंगे तो ज़्यादा मेरे ख़्याल से बेहतर होगा. इस मौके पे मैं दो तीन बातें ज़रूर कहना चाहूँगा इस मौके से फ़ायदा उठा के. बहुत सी चीज़ें ऐसी होती हैं कि जो शायद हम अपने इम्तहान के लिए पढ़ते हैं, लेकिन जो लोग तालीम की तालीम देते हैं वो भी शायद ये भूल जाते हैं कि हमने उनको एजुकेशन की परिभाषा किस तरह से दी है, एजुकेशन की तालीम की तारीफ हमने किस तरह से की है, और हम उस बात के कभी प्रैक्टिकल की तरफ सोच नहीं सोचते हैं कि हमने अभी कहा था कि एजुकेशन इज़ ऑल राउंड डेवलपमेंट ऑफ ह्यूमन बीइंग्स, यू नो, एंड देन वी कंसंट्रेट ओनली ऑन वन एस्पेक्ट, दैट इज़ द नॉलेज एस्पेक्ट, और वो भी जिस तरह प्रसाद साहब ने इशारा किया कि इम्तहान की तैयारी कराते हैं। जब सिर्फ इम्तहान की तैयारी कराते हैं तो पर्सनालिटी की नशोनुमा कैसे उजागर होगी, ये बात शायद हम सब भूल जाते हैं। और ज़रूरी नहीं है कि टीचर जो शिकायत करते हैं कि हमारे पास वक्त कम होता है और कोर्स ख़त्म करना होता है, ये बात जायज़ है। मैं भी टीचर रहा हूँ, इसलिए मैं ये नहीं कहता कि जो वक्त हमारे सामने होता है हम उसमें उनको वो सबक भी पढ़ा सकते हैं कि जो सिलेबस में है, और हम उनकी पर्सनालिटी की नशोनुमा की तरफ भी इशारा कर सकते हैं, बशर्त ये कि हमें वो तरकीबें मालूम हों जिससे हम उनकी पर्सनालिटी की नशोनुमा कर सकते हैं। और ये बात कहीं ना कहीं हमारे टीचर्स में लैग करती है, और इसीलिए ज़रूरी है कि सब्जेक्ट मैटर के साथ साथ इंसानी ज़रूरतें और क्या हैं उनकी तरफ इशारा किया जाए। मैं एक तरफ अभी ये आपसे इंटरव्यू में पूछा जाता है कि आपकी अच्छाइयाँ क्या हैं और कमियाँ क्या हैं, बुराइयाँ तो नहीं कहूँगा, कमियाँ क्या हैं, और हम लोगों से अक्सर पूछा जाता है, और प्रसाद साहब से भी अक्सर पूछा जाता रहा होगा, कभी मेरे बारे में पूछा गया होगा कि मोहम्मद मियाँ के बारे में आप क्या सोचते हैं, और फिर ये भी कहा गया होगा कि उनमें कौन कौन सी कमज़ोरियाँ हैं। हम भी उससे गुजरे, और बड़ा मुश्किल होता है कि अपने स्टूडेंट के बारे में ये कहना कि इसमें यह कमी है, हालांकि हम उसको हमेशा बुरा भला कहते रहते हैं कि तुम में ये कमी है, तुम में ये कमी है, तुम सुधारो। जब कोई हमसे पूछता है कि उसमें कमी क्या है तो शायद हमारी ज़ुबान लड़खड़ा जाती है, हम कमी नहीं बता पाते। लेकिन एक हाल का वाक़या मैं आपको बताता हूँ। मेरी एक स्टूडेंट जिसने 3 साल पहले PhD किया था, किसी जॉब के लिए एक फॉरेन कंट्री में अप्लाई किया उन्होंने, मेरे पास फ़ोन आता है और आई वॉज आस्क्ड के इज़ दिस द राइट टाइम आई कुड बी एंगेज्ड इन टॉकिंग, आई सेज यस, ही सेज आई विल टेक 5 मिनट्स, मेंशन द रेफरेंस ऑफ द स्टूडेंट्स एंड देन आस्क डिड शी डू दिस and then ask what are the, in the meantime I started thinking that the next question will be somewhere what are the strong points and what are the weak points, you know, so I was getting ready for that also. After good points, and then when he asked what are the weak points, you know, for this job, how far she would be suitable, I said she gets irritated fast, which is a very common phenomenon, you know. But we never think that why should one gets irritated? It is a personality problem, or it is a kind of situation, environmental problem, you know. She gets irritated fast, and then she says, "Then I don't think it would be difficult." I says, "Listen my complete sentence, you know." Because she's very hardworking, and she sits longer hours for work. And when you are sitting for 7-8 hours in the library, and then there is something which is not, you don't like it, you get irritated. And that is the only time when she reacts with the people. This might be one of the reasons that she does not want her concentration to be disturbed, you know. And you can test it later on. Second thing, that she depends much on herself, not on others. I was asked that it means that she doesn't trust others. I said, no, I don't think this is what it is. But it is maybe that one is so confident about oneself that one does not consider others to be dependable on certain matters. But in personal matters, I won't say that particularly. We all have our strength and our weaknesses. And the teacher is the right person to identify the student's weaknesses more than its strength, you know. What we do, we generally concentrate That's why we concentrate on weaknesses of the students and forget about their abilities and competencies. I think we should concentrate on both, basically. And as a teacher, I would rather like to support my students on which they are good and also try to educate or prevent them from doing things which they should not be doing, you know. I would not criticize ki tum to, unfortunately, because I have not addressed the press, my friends from the press, and I don't think that you should quote it there. Agar hum apne students ko bura bhala kehte rahenge that you are no good in the class, you know. What can, why are you asking this question? I don't think this is the right attitude of the teacher, you know. आजकल मैं इसको ज़्यादा लंबा नहीं करना चाहता, लेकिन एक बात पर ज़रूर कहना चाहता हूँ, ख़ासतौर से उन लोगों से भी कि जिनका ताल्लुक साइकोलॉजी और एजुकेशन से नहीं है। आजकल नई थिंकिंग के बहुत जोर दिया जा रहा है, और नई थिंकिंग मेरे लिए कोई नई थिंकिंग नहीं है, लेकिन NCERT और NCT सारे लोग एक नई बात कर रहे हैं, वो नई मेरे लिए नहीं है, क्योंकि 1950 से शुरू हो चुकी थी। आजकल सारे किताबें और सारी निसाब की किताबों की दोबारा से तश्कील की जा रही है कंस्ट्रक्टिविज्म पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से। कंस्ट्रक्टिविस्ट पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू कहता है कि बच्चे में अपनी सलाहियत होती है, अपने तजर्बात होते हैं, और टीचर को उन तजर्बात को एक्सप्लाइट करना चाहिए और उसको पढ़ाना चाहिए, मगर टीचर की अहमियत को कहीं भी कम नहीं किया गया है। ये कहा गया है कि टीचर फैसिलिटेटर की तरह काम करता है। सेकंड थिंग, चाइल्ड सेंटर्ड एजुकेशन, प्ले वे, एक्टिविटी बेस्ड एजुकेशन, आई डोंट थिंक ये कोई नई बातें हैं। जब मैंने बीएड किया था तब मेरे टीचर ने भी मुझे ये बताया था, और मैं अपने लेसन प्लान में इस चीज़ को ज़रूर शामिल करता था कि कौन सी एक्टिविटीज़ की जाती हैं। लेकिन एक बात की तरफ मैं आप लोगों की तवज्जो चाहता हूं, जो शायद सब समझ सकते हैं और जिसकी तरफ हमारे प्रसाद साहब ने भी इशारा किया, चाहे ये क्लासरूम की तालीम हो या काम से मुताल्लिक बातें हों, और वो है रीइन्फोर्समेंट। अब जो सिविल इंजीनियरिंग के लोग हैं वो रीइन्फोर्समेंट को दूसरी तरह से समझते हैं, लेकिन जो एजुकेशन के लोग हैं, जो टीचर हैं, वो रीइन्फोर्समेंट को दूसरी तरह से समझते हैं। वो तालिब इल्म के रेफरेंस से समझते हैं कि जो अच्छी बात है उसके लिए पॉजिटिव रीइन्फोर्सर की ज़रूरत है, और जो इतनी अच्छी बात नहीं है उसको हमें अनलर्न कराना है तो नेगेटिव रीइन्फोर्सर की बात है। मैं इसलिए बात कह रहा हूँ कि कुछ लोग इसको कहते हैं कि हम एजुकेशन को ट्रेनिंग क्यों मानते हैं। ट्रेनिंग तो जानवरों के लिए होती है, इंसानों के लिए ट्रेनिंग थोड़ी होती है। ट्रेनिंग इंसानों के लिए एजुकेशन होती है, लेकिन अगर हम अपने इंट्रोस्पेक्शन करें तो इंसान मेरे ख़ास से दोनों चीज़ों की ज़रूरत है, उसको ट्रेनिंग की भी ज़रूरत, स्किल डेवलपमेंट की भी ज़रूरत है, और उसको ये भी ज़रूरत है कि वो एक अच्छा सोचने वाला इंसान बने, रिफ्लेक्टिव थिंकिंग हो। अब आप मुझे ये बताइए कि अगर इंसान में ये सलाहियत नहीं होती तो वो कुरान के 30 पारे हिफ्ज़ कैसे कर लेता, और बिना किसी गलती के वो रिपीट करता है और समझता भी है। तो अल्लाह मियाँ ने उसको ये सलाहियत दी है कि वो इतना स्टोर कर सकता है, मेमोराइज कर सकता है। अगर मेमोरी से काम चलता है तो हम कैलकुलेटर से क्यों काम करें। जब मैं स्कूल में था तो मेरे टीचर 1.5 और 2.5 का पहाड़ा क्यों सिखाते थे, क्योंकि आज मुझे कैलकुलेटर की ज़रूरत नहीं पड़ती, मैं ज़हनी कैलकुलेशन खुद ब खुद कर लेता हूँ। आज का बच्चा वो कैलकुलेशन करने के लिए या तो कैलकुलेटर का इशारा लेता है। नाउ आई व्हाट आई एम ट्राइंग टू से इज कि वक्त की बचत अगर हो सकती है और उसमें आपकी लर्निंग भी हो सकती है तो कोई हर्ज नहीं है कि बहुत सी चीज़ें अगर आप याद करते हैं, उनका इस्तेमाल करते हैं और गैर इरादी तौर पर भी इस्तेमाल करते हैं। बहुत सी चीज़ें आप गैर इरादी तौर पर इस्तेमाल करते हैं। अगर आप सारी चीज़ को एजुकेशन कहें तो ड्राइविंग इज नॉट एजुकेशन एट ऑल। कैन यू टेल मी कि ड्राइविंग, व्हाट इज रिफ्लेक्शन एंड ड्राइविंग? ड्राइविंग इज ए काइंड ऑफ इमीडिएट रिएक्शन, यू नो। अगर आपको स्पेशल अंडरस्टैंडिंग नहीं है कि गाड़ी कितने जगह में से निकलेगी तो आप दूसरे की गाड़ी ठोक सकते हैं, तो ये स्पेशल अंडरस्टैंडिंग कैसे आती है? मेरे ख्याल से मैं जिस बात को कहना चाहता हूँ कि इंसान कि सीखने के तरीका और क्या क्या उसको सीखना चाहिए वो सिर्फ किताबी नॉलेज नहीं है, किताब के बाहर की नॉलेज भी है और उसको दूसरी चीज से जोड़ना ज्यादा इंपॉर्टेंट है बामुकाबले इम्तहान पास करने के। मैं अपने तालिब इल्मों से ये कहना चाहता हूँ कि आप अपनी किताबों के अलावा, ये जो मैंने आपके लिए इतनी बड़ी भूमिका बांधी है, मैं हिंदी के शब्दों का प्रयोग भी कभी कभी करता हूँ, ये तमीज जो मैंने बांधी है वो इसलिए तमीज बांधी है आपसे कि आप अपनी जो कोर्स की किताबें हैं उनसे बाहर निकल कर भी आपको पढ़ना चाहिए, जनरल रीडिंग भी आपको करना चाहिए। अगर आप जनरल रीडिंग नहीं करते हैं तो आपके जो आपकी जो नॉलेज है, आपकी जो मालूमात है वो महदूद हो जाती है। और जिस तरह से हमारे प्रसाद साहब ने कहा कि इम्तहान के बाद उसकी कोई ज़रूरत नहीं महसूस होती तो हम याद ही नहीं रखते। एक तालिब इल्म जो इंग्लिश लैंग्वेज में एमए कर रहा है, इंग्लिश में एमए कर रहा है, मैं नहीं कह सकता कि लैंग्वेज में कर रहा है, क्या वो दूसरे सब्जेक्ट की किताबें नहीं पढ़ता? नहीं पढ़नी चाहिए। आप नॉवेल नहीं पढ़ते? पहले हम लोगों को नॉवेल पढ़ने के लिए बहुत मना किया जाता था। क्यों मना किया? इसलिए मना किया जाता था कि हम शायद कोर्स की किताबों में दिलचस्पी नहीं लेते, नावल की किताब नावल में ज़्यादा दिलचस्पी लेते हैं और कोर्स की किताबें पढ़ने से हमारी परसेंटेज अच्छी हो जाती है। अगर आप मुझसे पूछें जो नावल मैंने पढ़े हैं अपने स्कूल के ज़माने में, इस यूनिवर्सिटी के ज़माने में, आज भी मुझे बहुत अच्छी तरह से याद हैं क्योंकि मैंने बहुत दिलचस्पी से पढ़े हैं। क्या मैं उनको अपनी ज़िंदगी में दूसरी चीज़ों से रिलेट कर सकता हूँ? अगर कर सकता हूँ तो मैं समझता हूँ कि वो बहुत यूज़फुल रीडिंग है, बहुत यूज़फुल रीडिंग है। दूसरी बात मैं तालिब इल्मों से ये कहना चाहता हूँ कि आपका कम्युनिकेशन जितना अच्छा होगा उतने ही आप ज़िंदगी में कामयाब होंगे। डिग्री लेने से आप एलिजिबल तो ज़रूर हो जाते हैं लेकिन कामयाबी की कोई गारंटी नहीं होगी। कम्युनिकेशन जितना अच्छा होगा, और वो कैसे अच्छा होगा कि जब आपका रीडिंग कैनवास बड़ा हो जाता है तो कम्युनिकेशन अपने आप बेहतर हो जाता है। आप अपने सब्जेक्ट को दूसरी चीज़ों से जोड़ने के अहल हो जाते हैं। मैं अगर इस बात की जुरत करूं ये कहना कि नॉलेज एक बहुत बड़ा ग्रुप है और उसको हम, क्योंकि इंसानी जहन महदूद है, उसको हम तकसीम करते हैं छोटे छोटे सब्जेक्ट्स में और डिसिप्लिन्स में और उसको स्टडी करते हैं, लेकिन कोई एक चीज़ कामयाब होने के लिए सब चीज़ की थोड़ी थोड़ी नॉलेज नहीं, अच्छी नॉलेज होना बहुत ज़रूरी है। इंसानी जिस्म उसकी सबसे बड़ी मिसाल है। अगर डॉक्टर साहब जो यहाँ तशरीफ़ रखते हैं अगर गलत डायग्नोज कर लें तो गलत दवा देंगे, अगर टाइफाइड डायग्नोज करें और उसको डेंगू है तो वो बेचारा वैसे मर जाएगा। तख्सीस बहुत ज़रूरी है और उसके सिम्टम्स बहुत ज़रूरी हैं। मैं ह्यूमन बॉडी का इसलिए तस्करा कर रहा हूँ कि आप उसमें फिजिक्स का इस्तेमाल कर सकते हैं, उसमें केमिस्ट्री का इस्तेमाल कर सकते हैं, उसमें बायोलॉजी का इस्तेमाल भी आप देख लें, उसमें साइकोलॉजी का इस्तेमाल भी देख लें, उसमें सोशियोलॉजी का इस्तेमाल देख लें। ह्यूमन बॉडी और ह्यूमन इटसेल्फ, यू नो एवरीथिंग इज राइट देयर, यू नो हु वुड अंडरस्टैंड। इफ आई अंडरस्टैंड द प्रॉब्लम ऑफ ए स्टूडेंट आई थिंक आई हैव टू लुक फ्रॉम ऑल पॉसिबल एंगल्स अबाउट विच आई हैव सम नॉलेज। आई थिंक आई टेक इन लिटिल मोर टाइम, आई थॉट आई वुड surely talk about two things basically. A vast reading would surely help you to develop your personality. And second thing, that if you have a good communication with good understanding of different subjects, you can surely make your place in the society, you know. I don't want the students who can take degrees and then they, because हमें नौकरी तो मिल जाएगी क्योंकि इंटरव्यू में कुछ ना कुछ हम कर लेंगे और उसके बाद नौकरी मिल जाएगी, लेकिन आपको ज़िंदगी भर तसल्ली नहीं होगी। और अगर आपको उससे तसल्ली होती है तो आप एक अच्छे इंसान कभी नहीं बन सकते। माफ़ कीजिएगा, अच्छे इंसान उस वक्त बन सकते हैं कि जब आपने कुछ ना कुछ सोसाइटी को कंट्रीब्यूट किया है। सोसाइटी से जब आप हासिल करने की कोशिश करते हैं तो सोसाइटी को कंट्रीब्यूट करने के बारे में भी ज़रूर सोचना चाहिए। आखिरी एक चीज़, क्योंकि लाइब्रेरियन साहब मुझे नज़र आ गए तो मैं एक बात कहना चाहता हूँ। लाइब्रेरी का इस्तेमाल मैंने एक ही बार विजिट की है लेकिन मुझे लगता है कि लाइब्रेरी का इस्तेमाल हम लोग बहुत कम करते हैं। मैं ये पूछूं कि क्या हमारे लाइब्रेरी में अरबिक इंग्लिश डिक्शनरी है, अरबिक उर्दू डिक्शनरी है, पर्शियन उर्दू डिक्शनरी है, संस्कृत उर्दू डिक्शनरी है। अगर हम ये महसूस करते हैं कि अब हमने तो असेसमेंट नहीं किया, जिसने भी किया ऑब्जेक्टिव असेसमेंट किया, इस बात की बहुत खुशी है कि जिस चीज़ को हम ये समझते हैं कि अभी हमें बहुत कमियां हैं तब हम सिक्स्थ हैं, तो हम इससे ज़्यादा उम्मीद करते हैं कि हम इसको बहुत बेहतर बनाने में अपना पूरा पूरा योगदान देंगे। इसके साथ ही मैं इस मौके से फ़ायदा उठा के अपने साथियों का शुक्रगुजार हूँ कि जिन्होंने मेरे 3 या 4 महीने के दौर में, मैंने बहुत ये महसूस कर रहा हूँ कि सिस्टम में काफ़ी तब्दीलियाँ आ रही हैं और सिस्टम अब फिर से मेरे ख़्याल से एक ऐसा बन रहा है, और इसमें आप सब लोगों का तआवुन ही इस बात की दलील है कि ये सिस्टम बेहतर हो रहा है, चाहे वो फाइलिंग सिस्टम हो या क्लास का सिस्टम हो। आगे भी उम्मीद है कि ऐसे सिस्टम को बेहतर बनाने में हम लगे रहेंगे, कोशिश करेंगे, जिससे हमारे तालिब इल्मों को कम से कम परेशानियां हों और टीचर्स को ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा सहूलत मुहैया हों। मैं इस बात के बारे में भी यहाँ इस कहना चाहता हूँ कि जो टीचर साहिबान अच्छा काम करते हैं और जो टीचर साहिबान आगे बढ़ना चाहते हैं, उनके लिए मौके ज़रूर होंगे, लेकिन वक्त आने दीजिए, इंशाल्लाह आपको ज़रूर वो सहूलतें मिलेंगी कि जो दूसरे यूनिवर्सिटी में मिलती रही हैं। वैसे वासे साहब दूसरे लोगों का शुक्रिया ज़रूर अदा करेंगे, लेकिन मैं वासे साहब का शुक्रिया ज़रूर अदा करता हूँ कि उन्होंने इस मौके पर ये ऑर्गेनाइज़ किया और मुझे भी इस बात का मौका मिला कि मैं अपने साथियों से बातचीत कर सकूं। प्रेस भी हमारे लिए हमारा बहुत तआवुन करता है, और प्रेस का भी मैं मशकूर हूं कि वो हमारी ख़बरों को बग़ैर किसी तआमुल के शाये करते हैं, और इस तरह से हमारी यूनिवर्सिटी का एक नाम जो लोगों को पहुंचना चाहिए वो पहुंचता रहता है। एक ये यूनिवर्सिटी अभी 12 साल हुए हैं, 12 साल यूनिवर्सिटी की ज़िंदगी में कोई बहुत लंबी मुद्दत नहीं होती है, लेकिन 12 साल में जो भी इस यूनिवर्सिटी ने किया है वो काबिले सताइश है। हम उम्मीद करते हैं कि आने वाले 5-10 साल में ये यूनिवर्सिटी ऐसे मकाम पर पहुँचेगी जहाँ हम ये कह सकते हैं कि हमारे तालिब इल्मों का अपने आप से दूसरे कोर्सेज में सिलेक्शन या दूसरी जगहों पर सिलेक्शन हो जाता है। अगर हमारे तालिब इल्म यहाँ से निकलने के बाद ये महसूस करते हैं कि उनको वो स्किल्स या नॉलेज मुहैया नहीं की गई जो बाहर ज़रूरत है, तो मैं समझता हूँ कि हमने अपना काम ठीक से नहीं किया, और इसके लिए बहुत ज़रूरी है कि हम अपने जो ज़रूरतें सोसाइटी की हैं उसको भी जहन में रखें कि जिस तरह से हम तालिब इल्मों को तैयार करते हैं। इन चंद अल्फाजों के साथ मैं अपनी बात ख़त्म करता हूँ, और एक फिर एक बार आप सब लोगों का बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया। थैंक यू।